when my mother, who had a tremendous premonition of danger, when she found that we were going in the Titanic, she said to my father, that is the ship they say is unsinkable, and that's flying in the face of God.
When you go down to look at the Titanic, the bow reminds you of what it was, majestic, upright on the bottom, noble. And so we were able to go and actually re-witness it through our exploration. My world has always been an underwater world. Everything I ever dreamed about was always underwater, and certainly the Titanic was one of the Mount Everests of the deep.
We were going to build this vehicle that could go down and look at the bottom and provide video up a 20,000 foot piece of cable, and we were going to go for the biggest prize there was, which was the Titanic.
Forward, wide.
It's sort of like Star Trek. You're Captain Kirk in a high-tech room with your windows being TV monitors. It's very easy to lapse through those windows and think you're in an imaginary submarine.
We had days upon days of staring at this mud on the bottom. You've always got that fear that if you take your eyes away for a second, something may just be slightly on the edge of the picture that could be the first telltale sign of the Titanic debris field.
Your eyes are glazed over, you're having a hard time staying awake, and we began to see some debris.
Wreckage.
Oh, I love it, I love it.
And in this sort of accelerating crescendo that didn't take very long, we came over top of a boiler.
And as soon as we saw that boiler, that's when everyone exploded in the control van.
Fantastic! All right!
God damn!
Now, we hadn't found the ship, but we knew we were in the right area.
Once you see the shape of the debris field, you can actually see how it's oriented, and then walk your way right in to the main piece of it.
We came in and we're looking at nothingness. And all of a sudden, the ship starts to advance across the frame. You can see the edge of the Titanic. I can remember those images to this second. We came in on the starboard side of the ship, a beam of the bridge, up over the boat deck. But we didn't know. Our minds are just scrambling, looking at pictures. Where are we?
Down three.
You sort of pace back and forth, taking in as much information as you can, trying to create a three-dimensional image in your mind.
Holy smokes.
Whoa!
Look at that, okay? Telephoto. Okay, back up. That's the bow, where's the boom?
Beautiful.
And they weren't the greatest images in the world, but it didn't matter. It was like walking on the moon. Neil Armstrong's black and white was pretty bad video, but it was the moon.
It's a bow.
It's always a chain.
You are starting to go where no one has gone before. You're about to step over the cliff and see if you're levitating and don't fall. But the truth came of, finally, you're going to have to actually go and eyeball the ship itself. And we were terrified of it because of the rigging, the smokestacks, all the cables. We had no idea what was waiting for us. It was a monster out there. And we had to drop down to go visual.
That's it. That's it.
Keep going.
Beautiful.
Pivot right.
There it is.
That's it.
What a shot, huh?
What a shot.
What a pilot.
What a pilot.
Atlantis 2, this is the Alvin. We are at the Titanic, over.
Hey. Roger, Alvin, we understand you found the Titanic. Over.
I approached Titanic not with any personal affection or emotion attached to the Titanic. It was more technical. But in going through that history, then you get taken in. I mean, it starts to become a part of you as a human being, not just as a professional.
Here's the cat scans that have the shiny tops on them. Yeah, go over there.
And look at that video, Bob. That is tremendous.
If pivot left slightly, Ralph, we got a beautiful shot.
Tapes are running.
I would just go and sit down right here. This is a safe place.
So having the ability to deploy a 35 millimeter video system gave us the potential for going and penetrating inside the hull.
Look forward, tethering out.
My goal was not to find the Titanic. That wasn't my dream. My dream was to go inside. And to do that, I had to figure out how to get in. And I didn't want to go down the holes and look at cargo. I wanted to get into the first class portion of the ship.
There's a chandelier hanging from the ceiling about three decks down. We're looking at a chandelier. That's it. Go up closer. Rise up a little. That is a chandelier. Try to go in and take a real nice close-up of that.
When you look at the wreckage of the ship, you're flashing back. You are re-witnessing the calamity. You are an eyewitness to the account because you see exactly what really happened, still preserved.
My main thing about the Titanic is the terror that I felt that night.
When the impact came, well, they all rushed out to see what was the matter, and they were ordered back into their cabin. And then shortly after that, the steward came in, said there was no time for anything. Just get out here and follow me. And so he took us up to the boat deck. And when we got out there, the last boat was going to be lowered.
Well, of course, the last thing I saw of my father, he handed me into the boat with my mother, and I thought he was following, and he leaned over and said, "Now, you be a good girl," and hold Mummy's hand, and I never saw him again.
My mother, they told her to stand at the edge of the ship, and there was a space about like that. She hesitated about stepping over, and they said, "Close your eyes, lean forward, and we'll catch you." That's how she got
it. As the boats came away and there no further boats left, that's when the panic struck. You could hear the people rushing about on the decks and screaming. I mean, imagine being wakened up from your cabin, coming up on deck to get in a lifeboat. Lifeboat, they've all gone. And the whole night long, I never went to sleep, and I watched that ship sink. It was a terrible sight, a great big floating palace with all her lights on, and then the dreadful explosion. All that noise, and then the ship broke in half. And the forepart went down, but the back, the hull, seemed to me to stand up for a long time. And then it turned over and went down on its side. And that's when we could hear all the people jump in the water screaming. And the noise was terrible. When I look back now, I've just got to agree with what everyone says. It was a fantastic ship. and it is, to use Dr. Ballard's phrase, a monument to man's arrogance.
I wanted the survivors to give me a bronze plaque to carry down to the ship in memory of those who died. And Mother Nature reminds us of our mortality,
of our finiteness, and that she's much more powerful.
And the Titanic was just like the space shuttle. They forgot that they were mortal and capable of air, and it bit them.